go ahead and call the February 3rd, 2020 Solon City Council meeting to order. We'll start with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, roll call, please.
Mr. Bentley?
Here.
Mr. Katura?
Here.
Mrs. Meany?
Here.
Mr. Kalunas?
Here.
Mr. Russo?
Here.
Mr. Schmitz?
Here.
Mr. Zeller?
Here.
Okay, changes to the agenda. I'll entertain a motion to amend the agenda to add item 6, which is possible reconsideration of ordinance number 2020-18, which was passed on January 27th, 2020.
I make a motion.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion from Mr. Zellwin, second for Mr. Bentley. Roll call, please.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Kalunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Mr. Zellwin?
Yes. So this item then will be item number 6. Announcements are as published. Just a note, the February 11th Planning Commission meeting has been canceled. And also just a note that our next meeting, which would fall on February 17th, is President's Day. So this the meeting then will be rescheduled to February 18th at 7:30, and the finance meeting will also be that day at 6:15. Okay, comments from the audience regarding agenda items. So this is only for things that are on our agenda tonight.
You can't hear anybody back here.
Well, I'm trying to yell I'm talking as loud as I can, Roger.
What's that?
It's always a problem.
What'd you say,
me.
Roger? Get up front.
I've sat back there too, Roger, and I know you can't hear anybody, but I'm trying. I'll try to talk louder.
Want to sit
better?
Up here?
Want to move up?
That might be the. Yeah.
Okay, any comments from the audience in regards to agenda items only? Okay, seeing none, we'll move on. Our next is a confirmation of a public official. Jeremy, do you want to?
Yeah, I make a motion to nominate Tom Lobey as the city's law director.
I'll second.
Okay, I have a motion for Mr. Zellwin, seconded for Mr. Russo. Roll call, please.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Kalunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Mr. Zellwin?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, well, we do have a set of minutes we need to get approved.
I make a motion to approve the meeting minutes of January 21st, 2020.
I have a motion for Mr. Zellwin, seconded for Mr. Schmitz. Roll call, please.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Kalunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Mr. Zellwin?
Yes.
Okay, moving on. Planning Commission, we have no items. Moving on to pending item number 1.
Ordinance number 2020-15, and ordinance authorizing payment to the City of Cleveland Division of Water for the annual fee charge for the use of water from fire hydrants for the year 2020 and declaring an emergency, and this is the second reading.
Okay, we're going to leave this on second reading. This came out of our last finance meeting, and I know, correct, Mr. Rubino, I know all of us on the committee had some questions about this, so we'll then leave this on second reading. Okay, moving on to correspondence, item number 2.
A renewal application for placement of farmland in an agricultural district was received from Carol Helberg for a property located at 6618 Chagrin River Road, permanent parcel numbers 955-05004 and 955-05005.
I would like to make the motion to schedule a public hearing for this item, please.
I'll second.
Okay, motion for Mr. Bentley, seconded for Mr. Russo. Roll call, please.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Kalunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Mr. Zellwin?
Yes.
Item 3.
Liquor permit application for Marjas Shandu LLC, doing business as 7-Eleven Store 36232A, located at 34050 Aurora Road.
Russo.
Yeah, seeing how there were no objections from the departments that reviewed this application, I move to not request a hearing.
Second.
Motion for Mr. Russo, seconded for Mr. Palunas. Roll call, please.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Shimmets?
Yes.
Mr. Zellwin?
Yes.
Item number four.
Okay. Correspondence was received from Planning Director Franklin regarding amending Section 1424.11b3 of the Building and Housing Code to modify plans examiner fees.
Mr. Bentley.
Yes, I would like to make the motion to amend this section of the Building and Housing Code to modify planned examiner fees, please.
I'll second.
We're not going to refer this?
I've got to refer it.
Oh, this is a public hearing too? I'm sorry. Well, I'd like
do
to.
Do we want to refer this to planning?
Refer it to planning.
Yeah, we're just going to refer it to planning.
Yeah.
Okay. So make the motion to refer it to public, to planning, mm-hmm. For this, to amend the section of the Building and Housing Code to modify the plans examiner fees, please.
I'll second.
Okay, so I have a motion for Mr. Bentley, seconded for Mr. Russo. Roll call, please.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Shimmets?
Yes.
Mr. Zellwin?
Yes.
Okay, moving to items under new, item number five.
Ordinance number 2020-19, and ordinance confirming the appointment of Mark Hawley to the position of Director of City Services / Service Director and establishing compensation therefor and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Matora.
I'm proud to make a motion under suspension to approve the appointment of Mark Hawley to the position of the Director of City Services, which is the Service Director.
A second.
Okay, motion from Mr. Katura, seconded from Mr. Russo. Roll call under suspension.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Shimmets?
Yes.
Mr. Zellwin?
Yes.
Final passage.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Shimmets?
Yes.
Mr. Zellwin?
Yes.
Okay, item number six, I'm going to need a motion to reconsider ordinance number 2020-18, which was approved by council on January 27, 2020.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion for Mr. Russo, seconded by Mr. Zellwin. Roll call, please.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Shimmets?
Yes.
Mr. Zellwin?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, so I'll read the ordinance.
So if you want to read the ordinance.
Ordinance number 2020-18, an ordinance imposing a moratorium on all buildings, structures, property, and land located within the Uptown Solon Shopping Center, and including all buildings, structures, property, and land encompassed by parcel numbers 952-19032 and 952-19018 until December 3rd, 2020, and declaring an emergency.
Okay, just before we vote, just so you know, so if you vote a yes vote, means you keep the moratorium. A no vote means no to the moratorium.
Correct.
Okay, motion so to, I'll entertain.
Motion to adopt.
Yeah, motion to adopt.
So moved.
Okay. Second.
Okay, motion for Mr. Russo, seconded from Mr. Shimmets.
Does everybody understand?
Yes.
Okay.
So.
Yes.
We're voting on
well, no.
No, we were in suspension. The only thing we reconsidered is the passage and adoption, so it's already been waived. This is simply to go to the motion to adopt, and that's what's in front of you, as if the last motion to adopt had not taken place. We read it, a motion to adopt, a second, any discussion on it. Again, if you want the moratorium, it's yes. If you do not want the moratorium, it's no. It's a brand new vote. Please proceed.
Mr. Bentley?
No.
Mr. Katura?
No.
Mrs. Meany?
No.
Mr. Palunas?
No.
Mr. Russo?
No.
Mr. Shimmets?
No.
Mr. Zellwin?
No.
Okay.
Motion. That motion has ordinance has no effect whatsoever and has now been voted down. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Moving on to comments from the audience. I just want to say a few things before we, obviously we have a lot of people here. I have a good idea what probably the majority of you are here to talk about. Just so you understand, you'll have 5 minutes to talk. I would appreciate if people that are Solon residents could come first, and then certainly anyone else, once everyone from Solon has spoken. If you also wish to speak, obviously you're more than entitled to do that. And also, just so you know, I know some people maybe will be questioning certain of us up here, that's not what this is about. I mean, if they want to respond, we normally will do this when we respond, when we get comments from council. So just everybody's on board and understands, like I say, you know, you're going to get 5 minutes. This is what we do for everybody and anybody involved with comments from the audience. So I hope everybody understands that. So I will now open up the floor with comments from audience.
Don't all come at once.
Good evening, and please state your name and address for the record.
James Rentmore, 32287 Hamilton Court, Solon. Good evening, Mr. Mayor.
Good evening.
I know we've passed each other a number of times in and out of the Justice Center for over the last few decades. Good to see you, ladies and gentlemen. I'm here regarding the property known commonly as the Lynch House. And I want to go through a couple things quickly. My family's flesh and bones have been in this ground for over 175 years. They were one of the families that followed Robbins and Bull into Solon. My name is on tombstones in every cemetery in the Chagrin Valley. I can't swing a dead cat without hitting one. Having said that, my immediate family moved here when I was 7 in 1972. I had the pleasure of knowing your siblings, Mr. Schimmitz. My concern here is a perspective for this body as caretakers of what has come before and what will remain when we are all gone. And that's what we are, caretakers of our communities while we are here. We did not create this community. We certainly have a desire to improve it. Plans come and go. I can bet my bottom dollar that over the last six generations that my family existed in this community, issues of moving things, destroying things, tearing things down came up. And in all of those generations to date, these structures have remained. They are items to be cherished. Areas such as Chagrin Falls, Hudson, Orange, that have homes of this age, build their communities around those homes. People are drawn to those communities because of the character of those homes as they remain. Other communities see us and they are envious. Communities that were built and came along after, such as Mayfield and some other communities around us that don't have these structures and the heritage that they recall. And as caretakers of that heritage, we need to pause, because once a nail is pulled, a shingle's pulled down, or any other effort to destroy the home, it's gone. It cannot be redone. I had the privilege of studying law under Professor Korngold at Case, Harvard-educated real property instructor. The term real property is unique and has a special place in the law because it is finite. There's only so much of it on this planet, and there's only so much of it in this community. And the character of those finite resources need to be treated with kid gloves and great respect. We are entering our bicentennial, as we're all aware. It's a celebration of what has been and where we have gone in the last 200 years. Being able to point to these things is paramount. The names that we see as we drive through our community, Pettibone, Carter, Cannon, Harper, Cochran, these are not street names. These are names of people. They rest in this soil and they gave us what we have today. We would not have the community that is so desirable by so many, but for these people. And you carry that responsibility, and we may lose sight of it, all of us, certainly in a community as a large, of the in our busy day-to-day lives, of what they gave. My dad made a point on every Memorial Day with the parade to visit those cemeteries and review not just my family's markers, but the other markers. And I would encourage all of you to pause and do that. Nelson Bard wrote the book about the first 100 years of our community. It's in the library. There's also a drawer there of handwritten manuscripts from the gentlemen and ladies who built this community that's available for everybody to see. And I would encourage not just the council, but others to make themselves aware of the stories if you don't know them. I would hope that, okay, thank you. I would hope that the efforts of a number of us will give you a glimpse into the support of our position to retain Lynch House, and we simply are looking first and foremost for time to continue the discussion, time to work out a resolution that satisfies the best interests of this community overall. Real property and those concepts and principles that go with it, the best and highest use of that land as it is. Having two or three more century homes with the rich history that people are willing to fight for is a small price to pay to preserve a piece of that heritage that cannot be replaced with a marker or a park bench or anything like that. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Good evening. Please state your name and address for the record.
I'm Lori Pitzer, 6608 Limberlost Court in Solon. And I grew up in Solon, class of 1984, married my high school sweetheart, moved away in 1990. And we decided to return in 2000 because we felt Solon was a great place to raise a family. And it definitely is. Time has passed, things have definitely changed in Solon, mostly for the good. But it really saddens me what little pieces of old Solon keep disappearing. And I understand progress, and I understand inconveniences, and I understand modernization, but to what extent are those things deteriorating our ability to share how things once were for our young residents? And I'll share with Bob, my daughter is now 24 years old. I remember her coming home from school so excited because she went to the Solon Historical Society. She thought we grew up in medieval times. It was just an unbelievable experience for her. And I know that the Historical Society is going to continue to do great things with their space, but one can only ponder what more can be done with more community involvement and an interest in preserving the Lynch home, like we have done with the Bull Home and the Disciples Church and, of course, the Center for the Arts. So I ask whether our council has taken time to listen to its constituents. I'm not an expert in municipal procedures, nor do I want to be. But there's something really wrong when the fate of a century-old building depends on an emergency measure where two council people need to recuse themselves and one councilman rescinds his vote. So I believe that matters like this should have normal three readings and allow residents time to speak with their council people and share their thoughts and ideas. And I believe that this approach is the right thing to do because in the past 5 days, as we've shared with Mayor Krause, we've gotten nearly 1,200 people that have signed a petition sharing that same vision. And I can read the petition to you if you'd like. I did bring copies, and the mayor has a copy if you'd need that. Would you like me to read the petition?
Sure. If you'd like to.
Okay.
The 1,200 names, too?
I'm not reading the 1,200
names.
So. Okay. The petition was written to Honorable Mayor Krause and written specifically by Kathy Bull Burke. She was a Solon High School class of 1983, and her family called Solon home since 1968. She's part of a group of current and former Solonites passionate about preserving Solon's historic charm for future generations. She's going on to say, on January 21st, 2020, two councilmen voted to raise the historic Lynch House. We assert that it defies logic that the majority of council and the mayor could be overruled by two council members. Restoring the home would preserve it for Solon's bicentennial in 2020 and future generations, and would cost Solon taxpayers $0 because the hard cost of restoring the home would be paid for by the Solon Historical Society, as per the lease agreement. However, costs to raise the home would be significant if allowed to go forward and will be borne by the Solon taxpayers. We are petitioning the Honorable Mayor Ed Krause to allow Solon voters to decide whether they want to see their tax dollars used to destroy this lovely and important part of Solon's story. This home is part of a historic corridor beginning with the Solon Historical Society and ending with the Bull Home. We believe the site is unsuitable for use as green space or an amphitheater, and it is situated in an area of heavy traffic. Please sign our petition and help keep Solon Historic Corridor and its story alive. Thank you. That's the petition. So I want to continue just briefly to say that the right decision might be to tear down the Lynch home. We're merely asking for the council to reconsider their actions at the last council meeting and give residents the time they need to understand what the issues are, time to prepare a plan, and the opportunity to determine how vital the Lynch home might be to continue the mission of educating our children and our grandchildren and subsequent generations. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. Please state your name and address for the record.
James Orris, I live at 7648 White Oak Drive. I'm also here in regards to trying to save the Lynch home. I'm probably one of the younger people in this room, so please don't hold that against me. Growing up in Solon, I have seen so many things come and go. I remember the old school that used to be on Solon Road. I remember across from my dad's shop, he's been here 50 years, and on Bainbridge Road, there used to be so many houses that used to be historical were gone. I remember when the wine store came in and took over the old electrician shop and fixed it up. And that was one of my favorite times, is being able to go in there, not only to buying something to drink, but being able to look at the old architecture. And they had kept the original ceilings, and they preserved it. We look at things in our city sometimes as value and cost. And I think sometimes that outweighs the real importance of something. We talk about the master plan and that things aren't in our plans. But the master plan should be a living, breathing document that should change with the city. It should change with the values and the feelings of this city. Just because something may not be in the plan doesn't mean it doesn't have another purpose. We look at things and we tear them down without giving it a second thought. And it's easy to tear down a building and just say, it's just a building. And it's easy for us to say, we're never going to be a Chagrin Falls. And we never will be a Chagrin Falls because we do keep tearing things down. We fought to save Old City Hall, and now it's the Arts Center. I think if we keep looking at buildings and structures as just an object without what it means to its community and the family that lived there and the love and the people that were raised as part of this city, I think it means so much more. And I think we need to stop just saying it's so easy for us to just tear something down. If the city wants an amphitheater, I think there are better places for it. I mean, we now have an open space where Liberty Ford is. That could be a huge area.
Not for long.
Well, but that could be a place. I just think that we as a community, young and old, we want part of our history to remain. And maybe it might not be a financial win, but I think it's a win for the people who are here, who were raised here, and who want their children and their grandchildren to be able to still see parts of this city and know where they came from. That's all. Thank you.
Thanks, Jim.
Thanks, Jim.
Hi.
Good evening. Please state your name and address for the record.
My name is Kelly Guest. We live at 35900 Bainbridge Road in a house that was built in 1878. We bought it. It was dilapidated. It had all the copper stolen out of it. It was in really rough shape. Now, people say, oh, you live in that house on Bainbridge Road, that old century home? Please don't tear down that house. It's emotional for me. I think it's such a beautiful structure. The architecture, the stained glass windows, you could do 1,000 things with that. An ice cream shop, something, somebody could purchase the home and live in it like we did. So I'm appealing to your sense of doing the right thing, and please save that house. Thanks.
Thank you. Good evening. Please state your name and address for the record.
Good evening. I'm going to set my timer first. I don't want to go over. My name is Jennifer Brush, and I live at 33425 Bainbridge Road. I am the third generation Solonite. My grandfather, Harold Scott, was Solon's first city engineer and is responsible for the industrial zoning that used to be our tax base until Columbus came around and took it away from us. My aunt Shirley Atkins lived in that house after my grandfather. She sang in the community choir with Mark Terra when she wasn't sleeping in the community choir.
That's true.
She was notorious for that. And I was a U.S. diplomat for 30 years. I traveled all over the world. But when my aunt was getting elderly, I inherited the house. Why? Because I had a son. And where's the best place to raise my son but in Solon, Ohio, the place where I was born? So he's not exactly knocking him dead at Solon High School, but he's doing a very good job. He'll probably be on the tennis team, I hope, this year. But it was the place of all the places I lived in the United States and in the world that I wanted to raise my kid. So you've heard a lot about the sentimentality about the older buildings in Solon, and I just wanted to bring up a couple of issues about the vote itself, enough issues to give me pause that before we tear down this beautiful structure, that we want to make really, really sure that we followed all the procedures that we needed to follow in order to make this decision. So the first point that I would make is that according to the Ohio Revised Code on Municipal Corporations 731.17, passage of ordinances and resolutions, paragraph 4 states, each ordinance or resolution shall be passed by a vote of at least a majority of all the members of the legislative body, which means 7. So now this vote was passed by 2, which doesn't come anywhere close to a majority of all of the members of the council. So I have an issue that an ordinance of this import was decided by only 2 members of the council when the Ohio Code clearly says there should at least be a majority of all of the members. You only passed on the lease, I think, on January 21st. There was nothing in that decision that said, okay, if you don't have the lease, demolition, and demolition on February 7th. That, Mayor Krause, was an executive decision. Also, according to the Ohio Code 731.05, the powers of the legislative authority of a city should be legislative only. It shall perform no administrative duties. It shall, well, it goes on, but as far as we're concerned, the council cannot say, and now because you don't have a lease, you have to demolish. And the council can't say, and you have to do it on February 7th. That is solely the decision of the mayor. So I call on you, Mayor Krause, to listen to the members of your community who have come here tonight to express their concerns about that decision and give us more time that you can hear more about the constituents' concerns. And you can marry those concerns with maybe the priorities of some of the members of the council. At this point, 2 members of the council, which is far less than a majority required to pass an ordinance. So for now, my 2 points are, the decision was not made by a majority of all the members, and the decision did not cover demolition or provide a timeline. But in addition, there's another issue, and that's the recusal. I know that the Ohio State Ethics Committee has made a reading about a similar position that involved Ashland County and the Ashland Historical Society. There's a lot of parallels between that Ashland decision and what's going on with Solon, but it's not identical. There are enough differences that I think we need to reconsider the idea that Vice Mayor Meany and Councilman Schmitz recuse themselves from that decision. I think we need to really take another look at whether that was in the best interests of the city, and whether their not voting somehow impacts the validity of the voting of the decision to tear down the house. So there's a lot of messy overlays of decisions and administrative actions. But in addition to that, we had a vote, Mr. Mayor. The vote carried the decision to approve the lease. And then a council member changed his mind. And there was a new vote. I read the minutes. I'm not sure there was a motion to have a new vote. But that's just another example of how this decision came about, with all sorts of murky and questionable legal proceedings that makes me wonder whether legal action is required about this decision. It's legal action that I certainly feel strongly enough that I would pursue, because I so strongly disagree with the decision to tear down a house at taxpayers' expense when the house would have been covered by the lease agreed to with the Solon Historical Society. So, Mr. Mayor, I'm appealing to you. It's all in your hands. Please give us a continuance. I said 2 months, 180 days is even better. 6 months is even better than that. But please, let's just take a breath, sit back in Solon's bicentennial, ask ourselves, and there goes my 5 minutes, is that really how this council and your administration, sir, wants to be remembered?
Thank you.
Good evening. Please state your name and address for the record.
Good evening. My name is Masroor Malik, and I'm at 7538 Stockwood Drive. And I'm still recovering from the fact that James called all of us old. I'm here on behalf of not demolishing the Lynch House. I am not a Solon resident for as long as a lot of these people have been, but we have grown really, really liking to Solon for last 13 years, and we love Solon. We love the residents. And usually, when you look at the cities are not the buildings. Cities are not, you know, the structures. Cities are with the people. Cities are with the history. And cities are made with, you know, all that heritage that it carries with it. And Solon has, you know, we just started the 200-year centennial, so Solon has that tradition and history. And, you know, so I would hope that the city council and mayor would reconsider not demolishing the Lynch House, because that is part of our history, that is part of our heritage. Recently, I visited Saudi Arabia, Mecca. There's a structure that's 6,000 years old that we make pilgrimage to, made by Prophet Abraham. 6,000 years old, but it's surrounded by the most five-star hotels or seven-star hotels you could imagine. But it does not diminishes the value of that structure. So I can't put parallel from something that Prophet Abraham made, but if you look at the structure that we have, it doesn't diminish the value of the city, but it increases the heritage and the history of the city that it carries. So I would strongly encourage for city council and mayor to reconsider their decision, and we'd hope that we'll grant the extension for the people to look into the lease. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening. Please
Hi,
state your
my
name.
My name is Susan Sendis, and I live at 32915 Arles Ford Drive. I also graduated from Solon High School. I'm not telling you the year. You can figure it out yourself. Mentally, I'm still in high school. But, or at least, you know, sometimes I pretend. Anyway, I don't also want to take up your time by repeating a lot of what was said, but I do want to ask you, Mayor, to consider the optics of celebrating our bicentennial as we tear down part of our history. As it's been mentioned before, once that comes down, we're not getting it back. I also think it's interesting that in a lot of conversation about what we want, a walkable pedestrian city like a Chagrin Falls, like a Hudson, we've got a great start, it's been there, a wonderful historic corridor that we should be looking at how to maintain, how to repurpose, how to keep. That's your base right there of having a city like that. I want to read something. It's very brief. As you know, we jumped on and used social media to do what we could to rally the troops. And thanks, everybody, for coming out. Jim Karlovic is also a Solon High School graduate, and you will see what he does for a living. History informs the future, and there's a long history in America of short-sighted decisions regarding particular structures not being valued until they're gone. Though I can't quantify the value of this particular house, I'm pretty sure that tearing it down in less than a week after significant public opposition has been voiced is a bad idea. Solon City Council and the mayor should put a hold on the scheduled demolition so that all views have been formed as the owner of a residential design building firm, that's what Jim does, that has been fortunate enough to help renovate and restore countless historic homes in Shaker Heights and Cleveland Heights. And I think he sums things up perfectly. I would ask you to consider, again, the delay after we celebrate the bicentennial. Give us some time. Let's get a committee of citizens together and find different ideas for that house. And then at the end of it, if you don't like it, let us get a chance to maybe have somebody buy it and move it somewhere. But everything in that house, the art that's in that house that is building a 100 years old is torn down. It's gone. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Anyone else? Good evening. Please state your name and address for the record.
Yeah, my name is Mark Yaks. I live at 36755 Pettibone. Sorry it took me so long to get up here. My leg falls asleep. Walk. Kind of weird. I got a friend in Solon politics. He's involved, okay, and he likes to see things change sometimes, and like I say, he puts money into some of these projects and signs and stuff like that, and try to get the word out, you know. And sometimes he's successful, and other times not so well. And when he's not so well, I ask him, hey, you know, what do you think the problem is? And he says, tell you the truth, all people care about in this town, he says, it seems like sometimes is whether the rubbish gets picked up or whether the streets get plowed. He says that's all they really, you know, focus on. You know, they don't get involved. And it's kind of true because with this mosque going up on Liberty Road, I got a lot of people even asking, hey, what's going on by you? You know, what's that new building? You know, I mean, I just got to shake my head. It's like, my gosh, I said, this is probably, you know, one of the, you know, big construction problems in Solon. You don't even know what's going on. I don't even know what's building. So a lot of people don't pay attention. But, you know, this Facebook thing about this house, it blew up. When I was watching it, you know, it was I was one of the first people to sign up for it. And within an hour, it was like 1,000 people. I'm like, holy cow, you know, this thing is on fire. And now I hear that there's 1,200 people now. And you know, it's really caught some momentum, and I think there's a lot more people that if they would get to know more what's going on, they'd be, you know, filling up that other room too. I really think that that's important to them. But, you know, we got like two kinds of people that live in this town. We got the people that come and go, you know, they're transferred here from Pittsburgh, wherever, you know, they come, they stay here a few years, our kids go to school, they graduate, and then they're gone. Some people just come here just for the education. I mean, sometimes rent is a lot cheaper than, you know, putting four kids in private school. You know, figure that. You know, you got four kids, just pay $2,000 a month rent, and you got your kids get the best education in the state of Ohio. So there's those kind of people that really don't have any ties to Solon. Solon is a stepping block for them, you know. They're in here, they get a good education, they're gone. And even on this Facebook page, when I look at it, you know, there's so many people that, you know, are all over the country now, and they're saying how much they like the old Solon, you know. And it's like, well, why didn't they stay here? You know, I mean, what's going on? Why are we losing all this, these people that grew up here and love this town? So I guess what I'm saying is, you got plans for this property, that's fine. I said, but, you know, we got a lot of people here that got so much history here, like the one guy with all his family and stuff like that. I've had family here since the 30s. They had a farm on Solon Road, and I've been here for 40 years. And all the neighbors on my street, I'm like the youngest one there. Everybody's been there 40, 50, 60 years or more, you know. So we're here to stay. And those are the people that you got to make this decision for, is those people with the background, the history, the love of this town. You can't make the decision for those that are just passing through. And I think it's important that we hold on to this house. A friend of mine, a builder, matter of fact, he took me through one development, and he says, what do you see here with all these houses, you know? And they're, you know, $600,000-$700,000 homes, you know? I said, well, these are pretty nice places. He says, no, he says, that's not what I'm talking about. He says, none of these homes will be century homes. He says, they'll be taking a wrecking ball to these homes in probably 60, 70 years. He says, the construction, the 2 foot on centers, they got 7/16 plywood for a rough flake board. He says, these homes, they look nice, but they just don't have the quality that was these older homes. This house has stood the test of time, already 115 years, I guess. And I just hate to see this go, along with you know, that McConaughey house up in Cochran Road. You talk about a palace. I mean, that was a beautiful place. My friend had bought it with the intention of redoing it. He was about 50% done with the rehab, and unfortunately he got cancer and he died. But that would have been a show place, believe me, if he would have lived out his dream. And I think that it's real important that we keep these houses. We really do. I mean, they are really gems that we need to have. But do that for these people, the people that turned out here, the people that got family, the people that are buried in Rose Lawn there in Mount Hope or whatever cemetery. We owe them people to keep this legacy going. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening. Please state your name and address for the record.
John Oros. I'm nervous. Sorry. 33122 Ashdown Drive. I want to say we moved here in 87, and I went through Solon Schools, and in that time, the city's changed so much. I remember as a kid being at the body shop and watching trains go by behind this building. They're gone. You know, I have kids now, and they go to this school, and I teach them how important the past is and history. I have antique record players, crank ones, and they go, what is this? And I, because this is history. You know, like, they've never seen this. I pull out my dad's old projector, and I show them, you know, what this is. And they're like, what is it? It's history. The kids are going to know nothing about the past if we keep getting rid of it. I don't understand what an amphitheater or an empty lot is going to serve this city. I mean, I'm not going to be taking my kids across four lanes of traffic to come down here when I think that property could be better used to teach the young, to show them where we've come from, how far we've gone. It just really upsets me that you guys could put a price on history. That's all. Thank you.
Good evening. Please state your name and address for the record.
My name is Joan Graining, and I live at 33490 Bainbridge Road, and my daughter lives at 33460 Bainbridge Road. So I have that whole corner. and I had no intention of speaking at all, but this is total sentimentality, in that I have lived in Solon for 70 years on that corner, and I have graduated from Solon High School. My daughter graduated from Solon High School. My granddaughter graduated from Solon High School. We have been here for a long time, and we've watched the changes, but we've kept our little piece and corner of the world to be ours and to be just the way it was before. And we have, for my class of 1961, we have every month the group still gets together and goes out for lunch. We have anybody who can that comes in from town comes in to see, and they all say the same thing. What happened? Where'd this go to? Where'd that go to? And we have, every year since graduation, we have a party every summer where they come in from all over in order for us to just be together. And this last year, we've had a number of people who have passed away, and so we are totally in sentimentality. But my thing is, and my daughter's is there's this one little piece of earth over here with one building on it. And thank God we have the Historical Society that keeps this part of us, our history and our love of the community. And I agree, maybe everybody is changing and the city's changing. There's a whole big city. I just am beyond why we have to change that one little spot to put up something, from what I understand, don't know, but the thinking is to put in a stage and everything else. In the busiest one, the second busiest probably corner of the city in traffic. Because if you haven't lived around here at rush hour and other times, it is crazy. I cannot get out of my drive. I mean, people will not. I have to get my car out and move it to the other side of the street because there's so many cars that are coming down here. And we want to build something else when we can have a nice historical place where, I don't know, when we had Girl Scouts and Boy Scouts, we've always taken them up there around to the Historical Society and things, that they can see what history was like, because kids don't know what half of this stuff is. And to have a place where we can have this is just, to me, very meaningful.
Good evening. Please state your name and address for the record.
Hi, my name is Elaine Rohde. My address is 9936 Pebble Beach Cove. I am not a, what do you call it, Solonite? Solonite. The reason I'm here tonight is because my husband's grandmother used to own the home that the city wants to demolish. I know we went through this a few years back. I remember you, Mr. Russo. And I'm just here to say, you know, I hope you reconsider your plans and allow the Historical Society to take over that home and do what they want to do with it. I haven't been real up to date, and I'm sorry I was late tonight. I've been really sick, and I had another prior commitment, but I wanted to make sure I made an appearance. My husband's grandmother would be rolling over in her grave if she knew this house was being demolished. And like the last time when you guys said you voted to demolish, the lights went out. Does anybody remember that?
Yes.
So I'm sure that's Grandma speaking from beyond. She loved that home. That was her anniversary present. She used to babysit that home, like drive past. She kept telling her husband that she wanted that home one day. And when it went up for sale, she told him it went up for sale. And he surprised her, and he bought it for her for their anniversary. And she poured her heart and soul into that home. She was also a huge part of the city politics and so on and so forth back then. I believe it was Mayor Patton. I could be wrong. Was it Patton?
Yeah.
Yeah?
When he bought the home in 05?
No, when she was, she always lived in Solon. She lived over by St. Rita's Church, and then they purchased the home over here. And I just remember her saying, Mayor Patton, I have to go. I have to get to the city council meeting. So she may have been a nuisance like I am. I don't know. But anyways, I'm just here to ask you to please reconsider. I would love an opportunity to get to spend some time, you know, visiting and allow my kids who grew up going to that home and my grandchildren even to have an opportunity to go in there and run around like my kids did. So I'm just asking you to reconsider, and I think everything that, that I've read so far seems pretty good. All we need to do is make a deal. And I'll supply a band for opening day. A nice classic rock so that all of us older people can enjoy over there. Oh, and I want the bathtub back in the house, Bob. No. That's all I have to say.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Good evening.
I've never done this with this teleprompter before or whatever.
Please state your name and address for the record.
Yeah, Timothy Boers. I live in Garfield. You need the address? 13275 Hathaway Road. I grew up in Solon. I graduated from Solon. My family is from Solon. Rothgary, Boers, Noble. Those are some of our names. My last name. So, you know, I want to bring this up so that you can see that this is where I brought to do it this way. This is obviously the kitchen inside that house, and it's actually this. I'm a remodeler. I do construction work. It's beautiful inside. It's absolutely fabulous. I don't know why we'd want to get rid of such a thing. Then you can go from the kitchen to just the cabinets, which I know that there's a plan to reduce part of that, from what I understand from the
historic. You want to move the picture?
Move it, yeah, move yeah. it. Sorry.
There we go.
There you go.
There you
I'm
go.
Sorry. I'll keep doing that. Okay. So I don't see anything really terrible about this. From the photos that we saw that at another meeting, these are not anything like that. This is must be like the dining room, I would think. Beautiful looking place, wonderful looking woodwork, crown molding, it's fabulous. I mean, I refurbish homes in Shaker, Cleveland Heights, and I don't see homes this in this great of a condition. Now this would be the living room area, and you can see that the door on the left over here, and then the window here, these are both stained glass. Here's a close up of just the window. That's the stained glass in the window that's looking out toward the Historical Society. I think it's just fabulous looking stuff inside here. These are the very steep steps, which we all know are dangerous. That's the way they made them back in the day. They can be altered. I know they can. I could do it. So, and I'm sure there's plenty of other contractors that can do the same thing. But it is a beautiful house. And look at this gorgeous trim. It's beautiful. And these floors, this is on the second floor. This floor up here is wonderful. I mean, that's over 100 years old. And look at it. It's in great shape. So, I just wanted you guys to understand that the house is not as bad as you think it is, or maybe you've all looked at it, maybe you've gone through it, maybe we should all tour it. I think it's really has some history there. It's worth keeping. And last thing I want to say is, I moved away from Solon in about 1980. I come back to Solon regularly. My sister is in Roselawn Cemetery. My mom comes back to Roselawn Cemetery regularly, too, for the same reason. I know that my final resting place will be beside my sister. I would love to be able to know that that building or house that we're speaking of, the Lynch home, Robbins home, whatever you want to call it, is going to stay here in this community, and I will always be happy and thankful for everything this council's done, because you guys do marvelous things. You really do. And years ago, when the bandstand needed to be moved, you listened to the people, not necessarily this council, but you listened to the council, and they moved it from the little triangle in front of the city hall or town hall that used to be the library, and they moved it over to the location where it is now. There again, you listen to the people. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Any further comments? Any further comments? Okay, moving on then, we'll comments from council. We'll start with Mr. Palouse.
I'd just like to thank everyone who came this evening and who has taken the time to email me regarding the Lynch House situation. I did support the lease agreement at the last meeting, and I explained my reasons why I supported it. And I'd just like to thank everyone for the communication and for attending this evening.
Mr. Shimmets.
I would like to thank everybody who came out in support of the Lynch House and trying to save it. The group that came together, the citizens group that came together, you know, they put a lot of time and energy into this, and you know, it's greatly appreciated. I would like to encourage the mayor to at least consider listening to what they had to say this evening, because he does have the ultimate decision with this whole thing. With that all being said, I would like to continue with my little history lesson that I started at the first council meeting. It was now August of 1820. The Bull and Robbins families had just arrived at the home of Amos Treats, whom Treat Road in Aurora is named for. Obviously, the Treats couldn't house 19 guests for long, so it gave the new settlers incentive to get moving. They soon found that one of the main reasons that the township was unoccupied was that so much of it was underwater. At least a square mile in the center of was designated swamp, complete with cattails, muskrats, and beavers. Even the fertile lands near Aurora didn't drain enough to make it easy to farm. And the higher ground up on the ledge had very little soil above the rock, plus the ledges were loaded with rattlesnakes. The two men finally chose land on either side of Old Aurora Road, which had been cut through by the army during the War of 1812. Mr. Robbins chose land north of the road where Grantwood Golf Course is now, westward towards the top of the hill. Samuel Bull took the land south where Signature is today. Once he had claimed their lands, they got busy building log cabins. They were finished in November, and the families moved in, becoming the first legal settlers in Milan Township. That's all for me tonight.
Thank you. Mr. Zellman.
Thanks. I want to start off congratulating Mark. He's a Solon graduate class of 99. There's a lot of Solon guys that work down in the service department. Jim down there works down there. I know there's a lot of guys I went to high school with, so congratulations, Mark. We look forward to you representing the city. So I want to address the Lynch House, you know, and I'm going to upset some people. Unfortunately, I voted to support the lease, but I'm going to upset some people. No one knows how I feel more than the guy next to me. I call him daily. Mary can tell you. Mary hears me talking to Bob all the time, right? And I take my kids to the Historical Society. I've been in that place more in the last 2 years than the prior 20 that I lived in this city. And, you know, I was on my field trip with my daughter. I'll be on the field trip with my son coming up next year. You know, and I appreciate everything that Bob and Mary and everyone at the Historical Society does for the city. But, you know, there's some comments that were made tonight, and I've talked to a couple people out in the audience as well, and I take offense to some of the comments. You know, and I'm going to start with the comment about time. You know, people say, oh, this was rushed. We had no time to think about this. Well, in May, there was a vote with the safety committee to tear down the house, right? It passed 2-1. I was the lone dissenting vote there, but it passed 2-1. Sue Reed from the Solon Times wrote an article about this after that safety committee meeting. And you know how many people I heard from that sitting out there in the audience right now, or any residents that I heard from regarding the Lynch House? Zero. I heard from absolutely nobody. Why wasn't this important to people out there now or then? But after the vote, it's important. Hold on.
Okay, please.
You had your time. I'm sorry.
Yeah, please.
But you had your time. And you didn't know about it. It's I read, forget about it. You didn't know about it. But no one reached out to me, right? No one told me how. I talked to Bob about it. Bob and I talked. And it was because of Bob that it was held off the city council agenda. But no one talked to me about it. And this is no different than the people that complained about the mosque, right? People came out and they complained about the mosque after the fact. And how come you didn't let me know about the mosque? And how come this and how come that? You know, it's not city council's responsibility to update every person on every piece of information that comes in front of the council. You know, and it's been disappointing to me over the last couple of weeks because people are upset at Bill and people are upset at Mackie. You know what? No one should be surprised with how Bill voted. No one was more vocal on their point of view than Bill. And that's, people, we're elected officials. People, the residents have elected us. And all seven of us aren't gonna think the same way. And all seven of us aren't gonna think how you want us to think. So don't, I know I talked to, now Bob may be upset at some of the things that Bill said, but Bob knew how Bill was gonna vote, right? And it's sad, I don't, you know, there are things and there's been opportunities for the last 5 years for people to do something with the house. The house was for sale in 2012 or 2013. People had input into the master plan. And I know everyone out there is like, oh, I never talked about, the Historical Society had input at the time to the master plan. I mean, it's disappointing. It's disappointing that the house is coming down. I'm with you. But we can't be so reactionary. We can't wait until after votes. You know, I'm a little disappointed at Ken. I'm gonna call Ken out. Ken was here the day that we voted. But Ken didn't even make a comment after the meeting about his disappointment. Not even after the meeting. And I haven't heard from Ken since. Right? And Ken was here to represent, and I hate to pick on you, Ken, because I like you. You're a good guy. But, you know, even after the meeting where the lease wasn't voted for, no one said anything. And it's, yeah, it's disappointing that the old house is coming down. But just because it's an old house, and people are gonna get mad at me. Just because it's old doesn't mean it's historical. And I've talked to Bob about this. I talked to Bob about this. Bob has told me that there's not a lot of historical significance with that house.
It's on a co-founder's property.
You can't.
Yeah, please.
Hold on.
So just because something's old doesn't mean that it has historical context. And look, I'm disappointed that the lease didn't go through. But we can't have revisionist history here. And I know that there's a lot of people out there that are gonna be mad with me. I apologize for that, but I gotta speak the truth. Thank you.
Mr. Bentley.
Thank you. I'd like to take this opportunity as some of the comments were, I changed my mind. Someone also, I heard that I looked at another council member or something like that. So I'm new at this, everyone knows I'm kinda new at this. So when the vote came, I was not understanding exactly what we're voting for at that exact time. Some of the items that come up to us, we vote three times on them. You know, first passage, second passage, third passage. I'm still learning about how the priorities work and what the process is to get that done. So when we were doing the vote, I thought we were voting on the first item three times. The first one was to, I believe, do it under suspension and emergency. So I thought we were voting on that three times after I realized that my second vote should have been a no vote. And everyone I talked to before the meeting knew. Everyone I talked to for weeks before the meeting knew where I stood on this. Especially all the council members knew where I stood on this. I told everybody explicitly that I don't think I'm going to be able to support this. So it wasn't a surprising one up here that it was a surprise when I voted yes. But so I took responsibility. If everyone looked at the meeting and I apologized then, and then the comments after the meeting, I took responsibility and said I made a mistake. I want to make this right. And that's how we did it. And someone said, I looked at another council member. I looked at the person who was running the meeting at the time to say, hey, I made a mistake. What can we do to fix this? So I didn't change my mind. I always had my mind made up. Everyone knew what my mind was well before the meeting, several weeks before the meeting. And if I did look at another council member, it wasn't for tacit approval or something like that. Or it was because I needed to figure out how we could make it right. And in my mind to get my, you know, what my opinion was. So I wanted to address those two things, and Congratulations, Mark. Look forward to having you here. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Pretor.
I'd like to thank everybody for coming tonight. I'd like to also thank you for keeping your comments respectful. I could tell that there's a lot of passion behind a lot of the comments, but I do think everybody was very respectful this evening. I guess I'll point out that I did support the lease, and the idea that there needs to be a pause or to give everybody time, I also supported that 4 or 5 years ago when this council voted the last time, when the Lynch House demolition came up the last time. I believe it was 4 or 5 years ago. I don't have the specific dates. But I also supported the preservation of the Lynch House, or I should say the lack of demolition of the Lynch House at that point. I would have liked to have maybe seen a little bit more effort to try to work with the city in those 4 or 5 years. And I have to agree, it seems like a little bit reactionary at this point. I think Ambassador Brush made the point that it really isn't necessarily a council action at this point. We're a legislative body. We create legislation, we pass legislation. The actual act of the demolition would fall under the executive branch and in the administration. So those are going to be my comments on the Lynch House. And again, I thank everybody for being very respectful this evening. Solon Comet, Mark Holly, congratulations. The bar's been set very high. I know you know that. You've been there a long time. You've literally done just about every job there is to be done at the service department. And that's why I am completely confident that you will excel in this new position. And I just want you to know that you have my full support. I'm confident in your abilities, and I'll do whatever I can from a legislative perspective to help you succeed and provide the residents of Solon the level of service that they expect. Those are my comments.
Mr. Russo?
Okay, first off, I'd like to congratulate Mark Holly on your appointment. I think that's outstanding. Mr. Loby, when it comes to your turn, if you could address the legal issues that Mrs. Brush brought up.
I will.
Because I know you addressed all of those items before we took the vote. Also, I'm going to change some of my prepared comments. I do want to commend everybody that showed up and spoke this evening. It was a far different than what was on Facebook. Just appreciate the fact that you stuck to your point of view and didn't make it personal. I think some of the comments on Facebook were absolutely ludicrous. For those of you that are just now taking the time and to get interested, I have explained my votes multiple times. At the May 2019 safety meeting, that's when the approval to tear down the Lynch House was made, okay? That was a 2-to-1 vote. Also the January 2020 safety meeting, and then again at the January 20th council meeting of this year. You all have the ability to watch these meetings, and you'll understand what my comments were, because I know there was a number of comments made on Facebook. Explain yourself. Well, I have multiple times. It's obviously, most of you do not agree with the master plan or the master plan update. I know that the mayor, Councilman Palunas, and I voted for each, and I believe Councilman Meany and Councilman Katora were on council and voted for the master plan update. And by the Solon Charter, each council person's decisions are to be guided by the master plan. Each of the master plan committees were made up of at least 12 or more Solon citizens and a community survey was sent out to residents to solicit public opinion. Each master plan committee lasted at least a year to deliberate and put together the plan and the update. Committee meetings were open to the public, as were the council work sessions, going into the detail of what was in the plans before they were voted on and adopted. None of you were interested in the master plan then, but now all of a sudden it's a problem. The Historical Society was involved and was asked if they had any plans for either the Lynch or the Bull homes that we should incorporate in the original master plan or the updates. They did not provide any input that I was aware of, and Mr. Franklin, when it's your turn, if you have any information to provide on your conversations with the Historical Society, I'd appreciate that. Never was there any time where the master plan presentation made where the Lynch House, where it was said the Lynch House would be restored and made available for public access. That's simply not true. Anyone can say that they believe that, but it doesn't make it true. For me, this was not about saving the vote, you know, or saving the Lynch House or putting up an amphitheater. And I said that at the May 2019 safety meeting, that any discussion of an amphitheater was premature and that this may not be the best location now for that mixed use, since the mixed use development on the adjacent property never materialized. As it turned out, the Citizens Advisory Committee made a presentation at a council meeting in 2019 and suggested that an amphitheater would be better positioned in the community park. Property that the city has been acquiring along Bainbridge Road over the years was in hopes that someday the city would be able to straighten out Bainbridge Road so that it would be properly aligned to improve the safety of that intersection. As for my concerns about conflicts of interest and ethics violation, the law director did tell a councilman that he could not be involved in any discussions, meetings, or votes on this issue because of his conflict of interest. That hasn't been the case. I was also asked by this person after a January 6th council meeting how I was going to vote, and then was asked to at least vote for an emergency clause and suspension of the rules so that the issue could be moved forward and not have to wait for readings at the next three council meetings before it could be voted on, and another delay before it goes into effect. He wanted to make sure that it passed quickly so the work could get started as soon as possible. So I was not rushing this through, but I was accommodating a request from an interested party to saving the Lynch House. I did not have any idea how that vote was going to go, but I knew council needed to make a decision that we could all move forward. Recently, older interior pictures of Lynch House were posted on Facebook and they were presented here tonight. Years ago, the interior of the Lynch House did look better. Mr. Dursick, if you have the opportunity when it's your turn to speak, I'd like you to show the recent pictures that you have. At our council meeting on January 20th, Mr. Dursick did show pictures of the basement walls that are crumbling, tree roots that are coming through the basement walls, and the temporary joist holding up the first floor. Also, the pictures that he had of the main floor were holes from the asbestos testing that don't show up on the pictures that were posted on Facebook or here this evening. That is how I know that those are not recent pictures. I have stated previously that any serious discussion of wanting to display historic items should be focused on the Bull home and not the Lynch home, especially during this bicentennial year. So for you that are out there that are just taking notice, this is why I have a different opinion, and that's why I voted the way I did. Those are my comments.
Thank you. Okay, first off, Mark, congratulations. Yes, I know we spoke on the phone a couple of days ago. You know, anything you can do, I know you're going to do a great job. You got a great group of people down there at the service department. So, like I say, congratulations to you. For all of you who came tonight, thank you so, so much. I grew up here. My family, my father bought the land on Harper Road in the late 40s. My five older siblings went to Solon. This is a really, really hard night for me. Personally, as a citizen, you know, it's tough. I have memories of that area. Some of you remember when Reach Out used to be over there, which was a counseling area for kids. So, you know, like I say, it's tough. As my role as a council person, you know, the decision unfortunately has been made. I'm hoping that, you know, we can move forward as a community. This is the last thing I wanted to see happen, especially considering this is our bicentennial year. This makes me really, really, really sad. And like I say, I appreciate everyone coming out. Unfortunately, due to the fact that Mr. Schimmitz and I are on the board, we were unable to vote. I think it's pretty obvious probably how we would have voted if we could have, but that's the reality of the situation. Like I say, I wish things could be different, but I think it's important for us as a community, and I'm hopeful no matter what happens with the House that we can move forward, and let's try to continue to work together. And I hope, I think as so many comments tonight, and I know it's hard because everybody has their own life, and I kind of joke to people, listen, all people really care about, you know, is my street plowed and is my garbage picked up? You know, and I understand that. I totally get that. But, you know, when we've had different issues in the city, you know, it's so great when everybody comes out and that, you know, this is what it's all about. I mean, we try to, you know, we're obviously, you know, never make everybody happy, but it's important as a community. And I always stress to people, please just check the website, see, you know, all the agendas, you know, something maybe will pop up. Like say in May, if you would have been looking and seeing safety and seeing something about the Lynch House, wait a minute, what's going on there? So, I mean, we try to provide for social media, and I guess I would just encourage everybody. I mean, we try, and we have newspapers here that try to get it out to people about what's going on. And I just think it's important, you know, if you really care about your community, to try to be involved and to try to see what's going on in your community. Like I say, this is a really sad night for me personally, because I love Solon. But like I say, I think it's important for us as a community, especially since it is our bicentennial, that however it comes down, you know, let's as a group, and if you're interested, you know, call, be involved. Like I say, we want people in our community to be involved in what we're doing here. You know, I think we have some good plans for some really cool things to happen here. And I think it's important that we get, you know, the input from the city. I know the mayor was doing town halls, and, you know, I would encourage that, you know, we continue to do those sort of things so that people can come out and people can realize what we're doing. But like I say, I can't thank you all enough, and thank you all for being so respectful. And like I say, I wish things could be different. Believe me, I get it, and I know exactly where all you're coming from, because for me too, you know, that whole strip there, I remember it very, very well. So again, thank you all for coming tonight. Okay, moving on to comments from the administration, starting with the mayor.
Thank you. Mark, congratulations. Mark's been a service director employee probably close to about 20 years or so. And what's really cool about Mark's promotion, similar to a young guy over there, Rick Tinelli, some of you may know Rick, it's about rising through the ranks. It's about promoting from within. I think that's, for me as mayor, it's probably the best thing I can do, is to make sure that whether it's the police department, whether it's the service department, that not only do we train people properly, get the proper training from all the old men like Dursick and Stanek and Bandiera, but you learn, you know, from all of them, and you did. And you rose through the ranks, and now you're in a leadership position because of all the training that you went through and all the people that came before you. So, Mark, you're going to do great things. Thanks for being a part of the team. Congratulations to Brennan Industries. They continue on their global headquarters construction update. They've completed phase one and ready to get through to phase two. And congratulations to Dave Carr as president. I too really want to thank all of you for coming out. I wish you would have been involved in this a long time ago, but it's good that you're here tonight. For me, I've spent the better part of the year trying to save this house. So some of the, Ms. Brush, some of your revisionist history that you set up there,
It's not, that's not good diplomacy. I could tell you that. I've worked my butt off for an entire year. You know how many meetings? Ken back there, he's a little shy tonight, but he could tell you how many meetings we went through and negotiated the terms and the conditions of the lease. We had the lease because of us, because we worked together to save that. It wasn't a perfect lease. There were a lot of things that Ken wanted initially, and we kind of a little tug of war with that. And but I felt it was a good lease. I felt it would have preserved the home. I felt that it was not going to spend any hard dollars from the city. It would have kept the home there. We took it. We actually took it to the safety committee in June. I wish you guys would have been there. I think it would have helped me out as the mayor in front of the safety committee. Ken was alone in front of the safety committee then, and the committee voted to tear down the home, which was, you know, obviously public throughout the newspapers. But we got to work after the safety committee, and we spent many hours working on that lease and coming up with the right compromises, the right lease, and we took it to council. We didn't get approved. It won't be the first time I've lost. I'll lose others in the future. Sometimes you win and sometimes you lose. As mayor, I'm not a dictator. I don't run a kingdom. These colleagues of mine are equal partners in everything I do. We're a team. We may be different forms of government, but we're equal forms of government. So everything we do is together. I don't know. Probably many of you haven't been in the home lately, I assume. Has anyone been in the home in the last few weeks?
Yes.
Okay. If you have, it's a, you know, as probably the more important job as mayor, I have another job. It's called safety director. And the home is a hazard. I mean, as you can see, the home is falling down as we speak. Take a look. Go inside. It's dangerous. It's a safety hazard that weighs on me. As to whether or not that home is going to last for even a short period of time. And so I get very, very concerned about the safety, the inside. Every single person up here went through it. I think everyone went through it. Spent a lot of time in that house. And we all have different backgrounds, but everyone up here really got to see. And you know, frankly, shame on us as a city. We bought it in 2005, I believe. And the city has not taken care of the home whatsoever. And I think it's on all of us. I mean, it is in such a state of disrepair that I have a lot of concerns about the stability of the home. I echo Nancy's comments about there's a lot that can be done. As many of you are aware, about $200,000 can be put into the Bull home. Which is the home, I believe it's about 1860s around when the Bull home was built. Very excited about the plans for the Bull home. And I know that through Ken and Bob, they're going to determine to make that historical society the nicest historical society in America. And I know they will. We have kids that go through that historical society all the time. I know that come June 14th, we're going to have a pretty big party on site for the bicentennial. We're going to unveil the time capsule and all the various things. We're going to do some Lolly the Trolley. Bob will hopefully show that. But, you know, if you look, I mean, I don't know if anyone has this pictorial history of Solon. It's a neat book. I've gone through it. I've read every page. Some of the things are here. Obviously, some of the things are not here. There's some buildings that are used to be in place that are no longer here. So my comment to all of you is we need to work together. I've spent a year trying to save this home. No one's probably worked harder to try to save this home, much to the detriment. I've had a lot of, we have a lot of employees there that have worked really hard putting the lease together and coming up to the various issues to try to save the home. And sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. But you have to be involved. I mean, you have to be active. You have to make sure that that area there, I agree. It's a beautiful area. It should be treasured in every regard and in every way. I mean, when we gather, and we'll probably have, we may have over 1,000 people on June 14th. We had 1,500 people at our Winterfest. Hopefully many of you were there just a couple weeks ago, but it was amazing, the outpouring of support for our bicentennial. So I'm with you. I agree with you. I am a historian. I mean, one of my favorite things is to go to a little city called Jerusalem, which has a little bit of history. And so history is critical. It's important to every city. Again, I want to thank all of you for coming out, for sharing your thoughts, for sharing your opinions. Many of you I talked to, got a lot of emails and phone calls and various things. And I just would encourage you to stay active, to stay involved. Try not to come after the fact. Always get there before the fact, before the vote, when council's voting. Express your views when council votes. Not after the fact. So I want to thank all of you for coming this evening.
Mr. Lobey?
Thank you. Number one, my job as law director is to attempt to try and keep the city, and I'm talking about the administration, council members, directors, in conformity with law. I don't write the law. I simply try to interpret it and keep everybody in compliance with the law. Nobody ever likes legal opinions when they disagree with it. And I understand that. And so sometimes I have to say things that people don't like to hear, or they wish I could interpret it differently, and I understand it. But I try to do my best, and I think if you look at my work, I think we've done a pretty good job because people have listened to me and we've avoided a lot of missteps. I can say that the vote that was taken last time did come in conformity with law. The law requires 4 votes. And that's what 731-17 does. I had good and long conversations with Ms. Brush about all of these matters today. I went through these matters. I'm confident that the vote did not meet the legal requirements necessary for passage. In fact, 731-17, which was cited because we went over it with Ms. Brush, says the following procedures shall apply to the passage of ordinances of a municipal corporation. Each ordinance shall be passed by a vote of at least a majority of the members of the legislative authority. It's real simple math. We have 7. 4 is a majority of the legislative authority. Oftentimes, and there's different clauses that are used, sometimes it's a majority of the quorum. Sometimes it's a majority of the present. This is the law from the Ohio Revised Codes that's been in effect since 1975 and has not been modified. We needed 4. I explained it. As for the recusals, I also did my research on that, and my advice was my advice. My advice is to protect these members so they don't violate the law. Whether they take it or not, I understand it, but I have a duty to try and inform them. I can assure you that I reviewed the ethics opinions myself. I read the ethics opinions. I read multiple ethics opinions. I called the ethics commission itself to make sure, and then I gave my advice. I don't do it so that somebody doesn't get to vote or otherwise. My job is to protect my clients and city council members, the mayor, and the other employees of the city are my clients, and I do my best so that they don't get into an ethical violation, so they have to drive down to Columbus to have to defend themselves against some ethical complaints, which are punitive in nature oftentimes too. They're not just civil, they're often sometimes even punitive in nature. So I have to be very careful when in doubt to make sure that I put my thumb on to make sure that you are protected and well advised. That's all I have to say for tonight. I thank you for your other confidence in your other votes, and I appreciate everybody coming tonight. I really do. I enjoy my discussions with everybody, and thank you. And if you have any questions, you know how to get a hold of me. Thank you.
Mrs. McCowney.
I just want to congratulate Mark Hawley on his promotion. I'm sure you'll do a great job.
Chief Tinelli?
Mark, congratulations on your new position. Very happy for you.
Assistant Chief Shooter?
Yes, congratulations, Mark. Look forward to working with you.
Mr. Rubino? I'd
like to congratulate both Tom and Mark on their appointments tonight. Thanks.
Mr. Holly?
Yes, I would like to again thank the mayor for this awesome and amazing opportunity and to be in this position. I look forward to working with you and all the members of council. And thank you for the kind words and all of the departments within the city, just to continue to make Solon a great place it is to work and live. And thank you for the opportunity.
Thanks, Mark. Mr. Franklin?
Just to answer Councilman Russo's question, I think about the quick, very brief history of the master plan and the Bull home and the Lynch home. They both were acquired in 2005. The Bull home was purchased specifically to keep it as a museum. That was the idea in buying it and preserving it. The Lynch home was acquired in 2005 basically because the Historic Society was there, the Bull home was there, and that created a square where you had an area where you could redevelop the area. From 2005 to 2010, and again from 2012 to 2016, the master plan was in process. There was 30-plus residents that were involved in that process. A lot of interviews occurred during that time, including with the Historic Society. Since 2010, the plan that you saw at the last meeting, basically showing the Bull home and the entertainment area, has been the plan that was approved by the Master Plan Committee and approved by council. So that's been in place since 2010 and unchanged. But there was a broad range of input in the plan over that period. Oh, sorry, Mark, I want to congratulate you. Enjoy working with you in the past and looking forward to working with you in the future.
Mr. Shaker?
Congratulations, Mark. I look forward to working with you as well. And no further comment.
Mr. Dursick?
In response to Mr. Russo's question to get some pictures up here, this photo here, if I got a document camera, this is when you come in the first door. This is one of the pictures that one of the residents had shown. And then when you turn around to the back side of it, this is the door that you walk in. And then you can see some of, like, again, like I said at the last meeting, so a lot of this damage was created by when the fire department was in there. They used this house as temporary housing while the new department was being built. Again, another photo that was displayed by earlier today with the stained glass windows and some of the damage that's on the walls, some of the water damage that's on the ceiling. One of the floors upstairs, it's just minor floor damage. This picture was shown earlier too. This just has a asbestos piece of drywall taken out of it.
I'm sorry, you can't, sorry.
This is the upstairs bathroom at the time. Then this is underneath the first floor bathroom where all the plumbing and some things were torn out. Exterior of the house, some of the deteriorating sandstone on the outside. And then the front porch. And another picture of the outside. Do you want me to continue with showing the pictures?
Yeah, I mean, I think the main thing was is the pictures that were being shown were not current. And I just wanted to show the current pictures for people that have not been in the home.
What was so different?
You can ask questions afterwards, guys, okay? Because it doesn't kind of work that way, okay? Do you have anything further, Mr. Dursick?
Just congratulations to Tom and Mark.
Mr. Bush?
I want to congratulate Tom on his appointment, and also Mark. I look forward to working with you as part of the Public Works Department.
Okay, bring it back to the dais. I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Second. Motion by Mr. Russo, seconded by Mr. Bentley. Roll call, please.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Katora?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Palunis?
Yes.
Mr.